Dear Mr. Zupashvili, Mr. Baramidze, Mr. Gigiadze, members of the Georgian Parliament, dear Mr. Ambassador, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, it's my great pleasure to welcome you on behalf of the Heinrich Böll Foundation, the Green Political Foundation think tank and international policy network. Mr. Zupashvili, we welcome you as the President of the Parliament of Georgia, a country that has gone a long way since the Rose Revolution in 2003. And among other remarkable achievements, you managed to develop a functioning multi-party system with a pluralistic parliament that has become a relevant center of political decision-making, which is not self-evident in the region, as we know. We very much appreciate your merits as a key Georgian politician with firm democratic principles. Our friends from the Georgian civil society praise your calm, your pragmatic and moderate way of handling even the most controversial topics in a polarized political landscape, a quality of particular importance in a country that has gained its own experience with populism and radical nationalism. We welcome you as a leading representative of a state that has made important steps in regard to association to the European Union, and that has kept its liberal pro-European orientation in spite of manifold external and internal challenges Georgia is facing. Last but not least, we welcome you as a friend and former neighbor of our Tbilisi office. I would like to use this opportunity to thank the Georgian authorities for the very good working conditions that Georgia is providing to all German political foundations. And this, again, cannot be taken for granted in times when the political space for critical NGOs, for independent media, and Western foundations is more and more restricted, not alone by authoritarian states, Russian style, but also by democratically elected governments. Ladies and gentlemen, the upcoming months are of particular importance for Georgia's further way to Europe. The NATO summit in Warsaw will have to find answers to Georgia's requests for partnership and support that corresponds to the increasing security threats that the country is facing. The European Union will have to show its ability and commitment to continue and increase its political and economic support for its associated partners in the East, even when it is struggling with its probably worst internal crisis ever. And Georgia will have to prove its democratic maturity through conducting free and fair parliamentary elections on October 8th, with pluralistic and peaceful election campaigns in the run-up, hopefully. As we know, the domestic political situation in Georgia is still highly polarized and full of tension. Therefore, I take it as a particular positive signal that Vice President of the Georgian Parliament and member of the main oppositional fraction, United National Movement, Mr. Georgi Baramidze, has joined this delegation and is among us today. Welcome to you. Mr. Zupashvili, I'm looking forward to your presentation. The following discussion will be facilitated by Walter Kaufmann, head of our Eastern European Department and the founding director of our Tbilisi office. The floor is yours, please. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and my sincere apology for being a little bit late. We already made a deal that it will be compensated, and those of you who can stay a little bit more, I'll be ready to stay more and complete our discussion today. Thank you very much for such introduction, Ralph. In some of your words, I recognized some ideas of Walter, probably, from the years when, yes, we were neighbors. Then I was a free citizen, not being involved in politics, and life was so beautiful then, some 15 years ago. It's more interesting. There's some beauty being in politics as well. However, yeah, probably politicians are there in order to make life of the others better and more beautiful, and it takes some challenges. I want to thank everybody, the Buell Foundation, people who are very tested friends of Georgia for many years. Thank you for inviting me here and giving this opportunity to talk with the people whom I recognize, some of you, and some memories became so fresh in my head from the years, which I'm going to touch during my presentation or during my talk about this very challenging topic, Georgia's way to Europe. It's really very difficult to identify the starting moment, because usually journey has some starting point A and ending point B. In this case, nothing is clear when this journey started and when it will be ended. In that sense, this is kind of eternity, because Europe is not going to stay at some point, and Georgia is not the country which discovered Europe just recently. For Georgia and for Georgians, European way is not something which came to our minds just 25 years ago when we regained back our independence. That's not the way which we identified for us some 100 years ago when we became independent from Russian Empire and we are trying to become part of Europe and to become part of League of Nations and to be part of the European attempt to create kind of different world which was emerging from the First World War. We did not discover Europe in 17th century when some Georgian thinkers went to different European capitals trying to find shelter from the enemies who were trying to absorb Georgia completely. Well, I don't know. Yeah, it is a very difficult task to identify the starting point of this journey. And probably I need just to abandon this task and to say that as far as Georgian nation remembers itself and has written history of its own development, Europe was our place. That's why we say that we are not applying for membership. We are just coming back to the cultural space to which we belonged, at least from the 4th century, when Georgia became officially became Christian country and adopted Christianity as state religion. At least since then, there were no times when Georgian kings or political elites or intellectual elites were not looking to Europe or we are not considering themselves as part of Europe. Even some 200 years ago, even more, when one of the last Georgian kings applied to Russian Tsar or Imperial Empire, it was in 1783 when agreement was concluded between Georgian Kingdom and Russian Empire. Even then, Georgian king, Heraclius II, was looking to Europe, because then Russian Empire was part of Europe, and we were trying to find protection from a European state. But Yeah, then our political elites did not have such much experience about Russian politics. And our king sincerely believed that, that the agreement would be about protection, about cooperation, about joint efforts to do something. Some 20 years after, Russian kings interpreted that agreement as our willingness to become part of Russia. And that's how the Georgian kingdom was abolished. During 19th century, all our writers, poets, philosophers, others, they're just looking to Europe through Russia and bringing to Georgia some things which were not so easy to obtain in Georgia. When we actually broke with Europe was when we became part of communist Russia or Soviet Union. That was the time, about 70 years, when, yes, we were kind of taken out from Europe, and we were taken to somewhere which until now remains probably one of the most, the biggest nightmare, and which, by the way, is probably the most important unsolved issue problem in Georgia, this post-communism and the mentality badly damaged because of this attempt to transform a human into something. I don't know what to compare that. The human which would not have desire to be free, desire to have property, which should not have desire to be successful, to have, I don't know, better living conditions, would be just happy from whatever was given to him, and so on and so on. And this mentality, unfortunately, is single most important obstacle right now when we look to this Georgia's way to Europe, the latest journey which started some 25 years ago. Because when the first foreign guests started coming to Georgia when in early 90s or late 80s, their prediction was that this country has huge potential to become a viable market economy very fast. And what was the ground for such thinking? The ground behind such thinking was that they found in Georgia pretty well developed small business, underground economy. Because in fact, this communist system, which was fighting against private entrepreneurship, never succeeded in Georgia. When I graduated from high school, it was 1985, the year when Perestroika started. So that was turning point in kind of many ways. But by that time, in 1885, when I graduated from the high school, what was the country look like? My father was head of construction company, Soviet company, and he was busy with taking to Moscow bottle of cognacs and bringing from Moscow huge amount of construction materials, extra. Because those who were sitting in Moscow, the one signature was enough to direct to Georgia some extra, I don't know, timber or metal or whatever, cement and so on. And then it was going in illegal shadow economy. Because together with building some hospitals, he had to renovate the house of the head of the Communist Party, local leader, some other bosses there, prosecutors and so on and so on. So, and I was looking at that, with this double standards or double life. He had the Communist Party membership card in his pocket, but on Sundays he would take this out, put on the table, and we together would go to some church for some religious ceremony, When they would come back, he would take it and put it again, the Communist Party membership card. So that was very difficult to digest what was going on there. But even my grandfather, who was communist worker in the communist farm, had to live with double standards because communist rules would not allow to have more than 2 cows and 10 sheep and I don't know, 3 goats. In fact, he had 100 sheep, I don't know, 30 cows and then so on. Just at the end of every year, he had to bring one of them to the head of the communist farm and then so on and so on. My mother was school teacher and she was involved even in this shadow economy because she was giving extra classes to the pupils. And that was, of course, illegal because you could not work and could not earn money more than what was given as a salary. All these things, most of you, of course, are aware of that. And I am recalling that. That was when we were not part of Europe or part of the civilization. And we were kind of swimming against something. And that's what damaged so badly individual mentality of our people and collective societal mentality of Georgia. That's why it is now very difficult. And those observers who saw this, they thought that, wow, you are already private business people. You just need to introduce market rules and everything will go so fast. But that was not the case. Why? Because together with this ability to find the ways to get extra income or to have some ambitions to have better car or better house or whatever, together with that, people developed the most dangerous disease, which is anti-European whatever disease. And this is not lack of respect to the laws and official regulations, but complete kind of just desire to do something against. What is written here? It is written here in order to do something differently. And unfortunately, this mentality continued when we adopted our own constitution. We wrote there that we elected our parliament for 5 years, but after 1.5 years, one part of the society came to the other part of the society with guns and said, you need to go because we don't like you anymore. It was our own constitution. It was our own parliament, very first anti-communist or non-communist government and parliament. But this mentality that, well, we need to be against, we need to do something which is not written in the rules or it is not agreed. Unfortunately, this kind of thinking and this kind of mentality became biggest obstacle for us. But at the same time, we achieved some remarkable achievements. Well, probably because of that past, we just badly want to become like you, Europeans. We feel kind of shame if we are not similar, because for us that's the final destination or that's the model. Therefore, there's huge driving force. There's huge internal desire to do things differently. That's why so many young people are so eager to get education here. Although some of us who come back to Georgia, we become more like those Soviet time citizens than European style citizens, because these problems are still deeply rooted. However, as I said, there is something which gives us huge hope. What are those things which give huge hope? Yes, we managed to overcome the pains of the civil war I mentioned, which destroyed lots of things. But as time went, in most critical situations we were recalling those days. And there are some people here in this room who recall those critical moments when the political process was at the point of a big clash, but then this memory would tell us something that stop here, you should not continue. Something like that happened in 2012 during the parliamentary elections, which is now widely regarded as a peaceful transfer of power. Well, that was anything but peaceful until the election day, because it was quite heavy clash between not only political forces, but strong individuals as well. But some collective memory or collective responsibility won, and we went through that challenge. We are in very difficult situation because of the neighbors as well, because we want to become part of Europe, we want to become functioning democracy, we want to become economy which is successful, predictable, investment climate is appropriate, and so on. But we have the fact that more than 20% of Georgian territory is under occupation. More than 300,000 citizens out of 5 million population is displaced from their homes. And this is not the case when that's the end of this bad story. No, this conflict is not frozen. This conflict is not kind of kept within some frames and so on. They're just UN monitoring mission people who are just crossing across the occupation line on Georgian proper side, not on the other side. And that's the mechanism which keeps peace there. But what kind of peace is that? Together with this, military bases are built there. And the agreements are concluded with the de facto governments there, including common security and defense system and so on. And they went as far as introducing this new concept that Russia, Abkhazia and South Ossetia are going to defend their interests abroad as well together. Referendum is going to be organized in South Ossetia probably very soon, with the question whether South Ossetians want to join Russia and become part of Russia. And many of you know that we are talking about this so-called independent country where, I don't know, I would not name numbers, very, very, very few citizens live there. Much, much, much more Russian soldiers are stationed there. And I don't know, 100 times more Ossetians live in Russia. So then what's the question? Whether they want to become part of Russia. So that single fact suggests that there will be more complications. But at the same time, we want to attract investors with long-term investment in energy sector, in infrastructure, in building factories and others. How we can do this together? Of course, that's huge, huge issue. Nothing to say about the other threats in the region coming from unsolved conflict of Nagorno-Karabakh, these new tensions between Russia and Turkey, the emergence of new player which is trying to establish itself in the region, Iran, and so many other things in the region. So all these are kind of problematic issues, and how we can reach Europe in a sense that Georgia wants to become integral part of Europe. Well, the answer is that we need to stress more on opportunities. And if we look to that side, the opportunities, then there are lots of things. If we had a map here, it would be easier to realize what we are talking about. North from Tbilisi until North Pole is under Russian military control. It's just Russia. It's South Ossetia and then North Ossetia and the North Caucasus and so. But south from Tbilisi, from the border with Armenia, then south from there, it's also Russian-controlled territory. They have complete military control in Armenia through their military base and their agreement with Armenia. And then there is Syria, Iraq, and then the Daesh and other guys there. So what is left is about 50 to 60 kilometer wide corridor from South Ossetian occupation line to Georgian-Armenian border, which connects Caspian Sea region to Black Sea region. But if we look to wider map, this is the corridor which connects Europe with Asia without Russian military control. And this is the corridor where all pipelines go through from Caspian Sea region, from Baku to Europe or to Turkey. Gas pipelines, oil pipelines. This is the corridor which was discovered or rediscovered once again by China. And they included this route in their new Silk Way project or concept. And they already sent twice pilot cargo trains from central China to North Europe via this route, which goes through Georgia and Black Sea. And it appeared to be much, much cheaper and much, much faster to reach, I don't know, Rotterdam. And they are thinking about renovating this railway connection between Caspian and Black Seas. There's huge interest from Turkmenistan, which has lots of natural gas resources, but at the moment have no other way but to deliver it to Europe via Russian pipelines, which is much longer. And they get only, I don't know, probably not enough. It's Iran who wants to deliver the energy resources to Europe through this channel as well. I can continue this, but it's not less important for democracy kind of reaching some other parts of the continent through this corridor as well. So when we are talking about prospects and Georgia's way to Europe, we believe we can bring something to Europe as well. In case Europe is not going to build walls around itself to secure itself from, I don't know, guys like Georgians or others. In that case, yeah, okay, we are out. But if Europe's identity is that this is the part of the civilization, this is the most advanced and developed place at the moment, there were other civilizations and there were other leaders in the civilization. If Europe is ready to assume this role and then to believe that this kind of situation brings responsibility about the future of the world, then there should be no boundaries, no walls, no kind of geographical limitations that, oh, probably Georgia is not Europe in the maps of, I don't know, geographers or, I don't know, some other scientists. In such case, yes, we could be very important gateway, very important hub, very important connection place to a wider region. It's Central Asia, it's Middle East, it's China and some other big players from the East. And we can do that. Because at the moment, Georgia scores very high in doing business or easy business or the tax burden or I don't know, registering companies or corruption issues or many, many, many other things which are so important for viewing the country from that perspective. One more contribution Georgia can bring to Europe. It's our very rich history to be located at the place where civilizations and religions were interacting to each other for centuries. We have lots of practical examples how we are dealing with different religions. And I'm not talking about only the religions tolerance inside the country. I'm talking about something else. For example, Georgia, for many Iranians, is closest different world. Closest different world they want to see. And it is very close to them. And they regard Georgia as part of bigger Iran in some centuries. And there were many Georgians who were holding very high positions in military ranks and in other ranks in Iran for centuries. So we can think about this, that this small country can be a good mediator or place from where Iran is reached economically, politically, culturally. Right now already many companies, I know at least five or six European companies who established their headquarters in Georgia but are doing business in Iran. This is kind of first step before they may go to Iran, but this is kind of function which we can perform as well, especially in this current very, very charged situation on similar issues and on similar matters. As I said, we have this experience how to be in that region and how to be in good relations with all the neighbors. We have unique, as some historians say, 26 century long friendship with Jewish people. And at the moment with Israel we have also closest possible relations. And there was no single act registered in Georgia. And Jewish people feel in Georgia like in their second home or first home or And this is happening together with our very good relations with other countries in the region, as I said, with Turkey, with Iran, with Gulf nations and with everybody. This could be important thing we can bring to Europe, not just issues which are problematic. And last and not least point, it's about security dimension and NATO and NATO enlargement and so on. Well, in 1 month time from now, there will be Warsaw NATO summit. Unfortunately, NATO is not ready to make bold decisions. Well, I believe there is time and there is unique opportunity for bold decisions in order to increase security of Europe, not in order to engage Europe in another conflict and so on. This Article 5, on one hand, and occupied territories of Georgia, on the other hand, are frequently mentioned as two realities which cannot be cannot exist together. That's wrong. That's wrong, especially when we speak here in this country. There are practical examples how these kind of things were dealt in the past, and we are aware of this situation, and we are ready for finding solutions without compromising, of course, on the issue of sovereignty and territorial integrity of the country, if things come to that point. But, well, it's more than clear that the thing is not now to that point. But meantime, we continue our commitment to NATO-led operations. At the moment, we maintain second largest military continent in Afghanistan. We are among three countries who committed themselves to send their military men and women who are in complete disposal of NATO commanders there. And there are no single conditionality in which areas Georgians can be used and in which areas no, and so on. So we demonstrated highest possible commitment to the international obligations or international tasks. Not because Georgians are most brave people, just because this was the area where we could be so bold. Because in other things, financial contribution or political influence or other things, when things come to some important world stability issues, we are not able to do that. With this, we want to send this very strong signal to our European friends who are pointing on some couple of hundred of Georgians who committed crime in European countries. Well, this is shame for us, and there's nothing good when you see that your countryman or woman commits a crime. But probably we should not point on those people only, and we should not forget those thousands of soldiers who are now in Afghanistan, and those several, unfortunately, dozens of soldiers who lost their lives there for fighting something. So they both are Georgians. And just to say that because of the fact that some Georgians are committing crimes in Germany or in other countries, and therefore, and so on, well, that's not serious. That's not serious if we look to numbers, percentage, whatever, I don't know. And if we see that several, not just one, European Union country representatives have higher percentage or whatever rate of criminality and so on, where that leads. Instead of identifying the problem and trying to solve them together, we have some calls that because of that some process should be delayed or stopped and so on. Well, good news is that our meetings today gave quite grounded optimism that these kind of issues are not going to be decisive and they will be solved, especially just taking into consideration our very good records about fighting against crimes and criminals and organized crime, and our willingness to cooperate, our records in the process of readmission of those who are here illegally, and the percentage of successfully returned people from Germany to Georgia is 96, I guess. So as soon as some problem is identified, Georgian government authorities are ready. So because of these complex things, I believe we should not be pointing on the issues which could stay as excuse for making this way longer than it is objectively. And very last point, that's about the balance, or not balance, but dependence on each other when we talk about democracy and economy and jobs and living conditions and so on. This is not excuse by any means, and I'm not saying that because of this fact any departure from the highest standards of human rights should be justified. But the fact is that when the society and the average level of Georgian citizens and households is 10 times less than average in Europe, let's say, but we want to have democratic institutions not 10 times, but even not 10% lower than it is in Europe, this is very difficult task. We need to work much harder on those issues if we want to see that human rights and freedoms are real, accessible, good for the population as such. And on that part, we need to work more, and that could shorten our way to Europe. Well, I'll stop here. I believe this journey will be interesting, will be challenging, but it is exciting as well. It is interesting because the target, Europe, is not staying. It's moving, and we need to identify where it is. I hope there will be no hard times after June 23 with this referendum. And we will not see that Europe is smaller. We want to see Europe becoming bigger. And in that case, we will find our place there as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Bartolo Dato, very much for this very interesting presentation. Before I open up the floor for your questions and comments, I would like to use my privilege as a facilitator just to ask you two questions on the domestic situation in Georgia. Your presentation mainly focused on the global context and the foreign political orientation. One thing that is at least confusing, if not disturbing, for foreign observers of Georgia is the relationship between formal politics or formal political power and informal political power. This has always been a difficult issue, but taking into account the fact that one of the main political figures today in Georgia is out of politics, Mr. Vidzina Ivinashvili, but is definitely seen as being one of, if not the most influential political power holder still. And on the other hand, the leader, or at least the informal, even formal or informal leader of the main opposition party, United National Movement, Mikhail Saakashvili, is even not a Georgian citizen anymore, but is the governor of Odessa, but still seen to be, or still perceived to be, the kind of main driving force of the political opposition. So one, of course, wonders what about the formal institutions of Georgia, the formal ways of political decision making? Has the space of formal political decision making kind of increased over the last years, or is it still so much influenced by informal politics?
Well, I would partly agree that two most influential political figures are kind of out of political sphere. One of them is out of country. However, I would rather clarify the, this notion when we try to understand what is the process. And the fact is that a former leader of the Georgian Dream Coalition and then Prime Minister Ivanishvili resigned from all the official positions, but it is felt that his word is quite influential, at least for his own party and the people associated for that party. And well, is this departure from the standards which Georgia had, and we are going back to somewhere, or this is kind of process which could be explained a little bit otherwise? For that, well, I have to say a few words about the previous years of Georgia. The least I want here to enter in any debate about what is good and what is bad, or who is right and who is wrong among the political forces. But the fact is that for many years we had kind of formal governance, because all the informal orders on every single issue, including what kind of color a building should have, was coming from formally elected president, and that's why it was kind of good formal rule when formally elected president would make all kinds of informal decisions. On the other hand, now person who took the power or came to the power through the elections suddenly said that I'm going out, which I believe was a big mistake, because it was impossible to just leave the room and then just leave the system as it was left, because the party he created was party which he created personally. People who came in that party came to him, not to the leftist or rightist or whatever, liberal or whatever program. And the dependence on him personally of the whole system was so high that the vacuum which would be created after he left could not be filled so easily. Therefore, I believe that was a mistake. But is it a kind of tragic mistake which pulled country back to somewhere? Or this is one of the issues or one of the problems which will be solved very soon successfully? I believe this is not going back to somewhere, because despite the fact that Mr. Ivanishvili maintains influence over the processes because of his words and his respect and so on, the fact is that right now we have the president who never listens what Ivanishvili says, sometimes just vice versa. is completely out of his Ivanishvili's informal control. And the president of Georgia, despite the change in the constitutional system, when he is no more head of the executive branch, still maintains quite considerable power in legislative work, in appointment of key officials in different structures, and then many other things. The fact is that the Constitutional Court, which is the highest possible, I don't know, judge on political issues, because unconstitutionality of law is quite high political issue, is out of control of that informal leadership. Somehow this is the reality and this is the case. It is more than evident that most popular media outlets are out of control of that informal leader. It's more than clear that parliamentary majority is hardly majority, because it is composed by different parties, including crazy guys like me and my fellow Republicans, who sometimes, I don't know, do things which nobody understands why we are doing that, because we believe some things, and this is part of the majority. Therefore, it's not such a clear majority. I can continue. So I believe this issue is there, but it's not a fundamental issue. I believe the next elections will produce multi-party parliament. The party of Ivanishvili, Georgian Dream Party, and we have a couple of representatives here, is led by Prime Minister, Mr. Kvirikashvili, who is widely regarded, even by his opponents, as very different kind of person, or a person who is not so easy to be subordinated to any formal or informal, unjustified, whatever, influences or structures and so on. Therefore, if I go back to 2011-10 and so on, I could not even dream about the situation we have now in terms of positive things. I know people are there who are having different opinion. I have my long-term colleague, Mr. Baramidze, who is here. Of course, he will have different explanation of the things, different opinion and so on. But yeah, they built the system which was, I don't know, formal, informal, this kind of that kind, but that was monolithic. Nobody, even one single local servant of local government, could have different understanding or different opinion or different decision making. That's why they were very effective in building buildings in 2 months, when the building process would require 2 years, but they would do it in 2 months, because it was very effective monolithic system of governance. I don't think that that governance system was good. I don't think that what we have now, this is good enough to continue, but I believe we are on the right way, and that's what will be probably demonstrated by the next elections.
Thank you. You spoke convincingly about the Europeanness of Georgia, and everybody who knows the country will confirm this in many ways, the cultural ties and the belonging of Georgia to Europe. However, over the last years or even months, we have seen, in a way, growing anti-European sentiments as well. There's so anti-liberal movements, anti-liberal statements by, well, partly by the church, partly by orthodox groups, by nationalistic groups. So the idea to hold, to change the constitution, to guarantee that never ever there will be something like an gay marriage possible, things like that without any. So do you see that together with some frustration about the social economic situation and maybe some frustration about today's European Union, anti-European sentiment and a search for different orientation is kind of increasing, is growing?
No. Despite the figures, no. And I'll tell you that anti-European sentiments will really grow in Georgia and would become a problem only if Europe manages to undermine itself. It's not about Georgia, and it's not about Georgians. And I'm repeating this time to time. Walter, you know that it's not about you. You are asking questions, which is kind of almost in every single conference and so on, this question is posted. But my impression sometimes is that there are people in Europe who are just eager to see that, wow, another 4% of Georgians have skepticism about Europe. Another 5% is left, and after that we can say that, you see, Georgia no more wants to become NATO member, Georgia no more wants to become part of Europe, okay, leave them alone, and they want with Russia, and Russia wants with them, and everything will be fine. No, this will not happen, I guarantee. This will not happen. And if the figures are taken, where public opinion figures were 10 years ago in Germany, in Austria, in France, in Netherlands, in UK, and compare what is tendency in Georgia. You will see that Georgians are champions of European values. Georgians are most patriots of European Union, apart some probably Baltic nations and so on. I believe we need to organize conferences and look deeper. What's going on in Europe? What's going on in European countries and nations? And what's the understanding of future of Europe? And the understanding of, I don't know, it's not in Georgia. And I am proud with my fellow Georgians that despite all this hardship, despite the war 8 years ago, despite the problems I mentioned about these occupied territories, and despite living under constant threat, despite knocking on the different doors, and we politicians trying to explain to the people that, you know, yes, the door of NATO is opened, but you know there are some things, and but it is still open and so on, and we are trying to convince our Georgian citizens that no, everything is fine, and we are telling together with you, Europe, that NATO, Russia does not have veto power or NATO membership. No, that's not the case. But you know, these Georgian people are becoming kind of aware of the situation as well. And in this situation, when 73% of Georgians want European integration instead of 78%, is that a problem? I lived in better country, in that sense, when 100% of Georgians were in favor of communism. And there were five persons whom I know, party founders of Republican Party in 1978, and they were jailed. The rest of the people would say, yes, it's fine. Do you want to go back to there? Is it a problem if 10% of Georgians are questioning whether NATO or EU will bring something good? But everything I said is not justification of anything not doing. I mean, we need to continue even harder. That's why this visa liberalization issue is so important. It's not about travel. It's not about people who will come tomorrow to Europe. It's about kind of integrity. It's about the values. It's about commitments. And then, yeah.
Definitely. And you are definitely true that Euro skepticism is by far not only a problem of Georgia. It's most of all a problem of Europeans. Tato, if you have another 10, 15 minutes, according to Mr. Ambassador, so... Yes? So I would like to give you the chance to ask short questions, give short comments to Mr. Usupashvili. Who's first? Yes, please, just take the micro and shortly introduce yourself.
Yes,
please.
Hello. My name is Michael Meyer-Resende. I work for Democracy Reporting International. And when one talks about Georgia and democratic development, most often people say the biggest problem domestically is the extreme polarization between the parties. I would be interested in your opinion how this will play out in this election process. What will these elections do to polarization? Will this remain a big problem or get better? Where do you see things headed? Thank you.
Well, it's not just about parties. I spoke a lot about the remains of communism in our heads. And the communism was not just words. It was quite profoundly developed concept. And the main part was monopoly on truth. And Article 6 of Soviet Constitution would say that it's a communist party which knows what to do. And everybody who would be against, they are not touching this, I don't know, truth. Since then, in Georgia, we moved to multi-party system. We have dozens of parties, but sometimes we, among ourselves, when we assess the situation, I'm saying that instead of one communist party, we received multi-communist party system. In a sense that everybody has this ambitions that I have the access to the truth. And if so, then you are just wrong, not partly, but completely wrong. And well, that's the source of this lack of realizing of these different colors. It's yes or no. You're right or wrong. It cannot be that on this you are partly right and therefore we need each other. So, yeah, we are coming from this culture. This culture combined with the strong charismatic individuals who were party leaders. And in Georgia, it is hard to name a single party Of course, other than my Liberal Republican Party, and thanks to Naumann Foundation and others, we developed some inter-party democracy. I need to advertise my party for some 30 seconds, okay? But the truth is that this is the only party which has former chairpersons and leaders inside the party, and we are four now. Oh, but current chairperson was working with Biol Foundation, so they contributed to party as well. Almost all other parties are founded and led by the person who was there. There are some little exceptions, but let's see. So that's where we are coming from. But for these elections, I believe this will be novelty, because instead of creating strong electoral blocks, when you bring together all your supporter parties and go on the elections with the idea that we will win absolute majority and I don't need any post-election negotiations with anybody. Therefore, I can go and just everybody. Now, during these elections, we will have different situation. There will be many different parties, and they will realize, or they are realizing, that post-election talks would be necessary. Therefore, the level of polarization or level of clashes and personal attacks and so on could be lower. Plus to that, we have people, probably right people in the political scene now. The prime minister who is leading the ruling party, by his background, his personality and his appearance and everything, he is not that kind of leader who would just polarize situation further. But there are some other people, individuals and some things which give hope that probably we will make step forward from a too polarized political spectrum.
So, unfortunately, I just got the message that your time is really more restricted than you than you wished yourself. So, therefore, I think somebody else is waiting for you urgently already. Dato, it was a pleasure to have you here. After many years, I remember years ago our conversations at Radiani Street in Vakir in Tbilisi. So very good to have you again at the Bell Foundation. Please feel welcome here, always in whatever capacity you will be. It's a pleasure to have you here. Thank you very much for coming tonight or this afternoon. I wish you a successful stay here in Berlin and I think in Magdeburg tomorrow. And I wish you successful elections for Georgia, not just for one particular party. And I hope that we will have even more optimistic conversation in 1 year from now.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Walter. Thank you, everybody. Once again, sorry for being late and for not having enough time for questions. But next time, as you said, probably I'll have more times after these elections. Let's see. Thank you.